Good morning, everybody. Good to be with you in our separate homes where we can worship God together and experience the presence of God in our homes. And I don't know the week that you went through. Perhaps you had some challenges like we did, and maybe you felt the odds were against you. Well, I want to encourage you that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Yes, the word says that if God is for us, who can be against us? Therefore, this morning, let us praise God. Let us give Him our everything. Let us declare His goodness by faith through our praises. And you will see, even whatever circumstances came against you, that God will work it out for you, for your good. Amen? Are you ready? Come on, let's praise God.
Give you my attention, so that for your calling, I'm in pursuit.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you and we give you glory this morning. Thank you that if you are with us, who can be against us? Thank you, God, you are the one in our lives that brings the blessings in our lives. You are the one that brings the provision and the power within our lives. And you are the one that brings in growth within our lives, our businesses, our families, in every area of our lives. And therefore, we praise you this morning and we give you glory. Thank you that even in a time as this, we know that if you are for us, you can be against us. We know that even in this time, you are working things for our good. And therefore, we praise you and we love you and we hide under your shadows, Lord. And Lord, we find our protection with you. And as we hear the word of God this morning, thank you that our hearts are being strengthened and renewed and restored in your word. Thank you that our lives are being restored in you, God, through Christ Jesus. And we thank you for that this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. So we've been looking the last couple of weeks to do life God's way. So this morning we are going to start with the book of Corinthians. But I just want to say, in the past few weeks we looked at Acts 2 verse 46, where it says that they continued daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house. They ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. Now, who of you wants the favor of God upon their lives? Amen? We all want the hand of God to be upon our lives. And therefore, we need to be accurate. We need to be accurate about the things and concerning the things of God in our lives. And therefore, if we want to walk in the provision of God, and we want to walk in the power of God, it means that we need to walk in the purpose of God. And that has to be the foundation of our lives. To love God, to love people, win souls, make disciples, empowering people with the word of God so that they can grow in God and that they can also walk in His purpose. But today we're going to look at 1 Corinthians 1 verse 10. And I read for you. It says, "Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing." He comes here and he says, you all speak the same thing. Why? Because we know that when there are two visions in one church, it means there's a division. If there are two visions in your family, there is a division. And therefore, we need to get to God so that He can give us the vision through Christ Jesus. That we know the heart of God. That we know the dream of God for our lives, and that we can bring everyone's heart in line with that dream and vision of God. And that is that none will be lost, but that every person shall be saved. Why? Because God wants us to have an abundant life. And he continues, he says, "So let there be no divisions among you." He says, "But that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment." The New Living Translation says, "Let there be no division in the church, rather be of one mind, united in thought and purpose." Now we all know that sometimes there are two or three or more ways of doing a thing. But here's the thing, even in church, even though people might be doing things differently, it is important that our hearts are the same. It is important that our minds are the same. It is important to have the same vision and the same word of God dwelling within our hearts. And this brings me to verse 11, where he says, "For it has been declared to me concerning you, my brethren, by those of Chloe's household, that there are contentions among you." So he says, there's a bit of fighting going on between you. Verse 12, "Now I say this, that each of you say, I am of Paul, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Cephas, I'm of Christ." In other words, they're fighting for their spot. They're fighting to be acknowledged. This tells me that they lost their sense of identity. It tells me that there is no vision, that everyone there is just on their own mission. They want to do their own thing. They're not working together. And now verse 13, he says, "Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul?" Verse 14, "I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, lest anyone should say that I had baptized in my own name. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of no effect." So the calling is not that we get baptized into an organization or an institution. The calling is that we will preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when people get baptized, they get baptized in Christ. And therefore, they can belong to Him. And now it says, and I want to bring you to 1 Corinthians 3, where it speaks about the same issue. It says, dear brothers and sisters, when I was with you, I couldn't talk to you as I would to spiritual people. I had to talk to you as though you belonged to this world, or as though you were infants in Christ. So you call yourself a Christian, in other words, it says, but you are still infants, you are still immature, you are still baby Christians. So you might be a Christian for 20, 30, or 40 years, but you are still immature, you're still infants in Christ. Or you might be serving God for 20 years, but here's the thing, you've been doing the first year over and over and over for 20 years. He says, you're not a mature Christian. Verse 2, he says, I had to feed you with milk, not with solid food, because you weren't ready for anything stronger. So he says, you can't handle the deep stuff. You choke on it. You die. It is too much for you. And now he continues and he says, and you still aren't ready, for you are still controlled. Now he says, why they are not ready? You are still controlled by your sinful nature. You are jealous of one another and quarrel with one another. Doesn't that prove you are controlled by your sinful nature? Aren't you living like the people of the world? When one of you says, I'm a follower of Paul, and another says, I follow Apollos, aren't you acting just like the people of the world? So there's jealousy, there's quarreling. It says in verse 5, after all, who is Apollos? Who is Paul? We are only God's servants. We are only God's servants through whom you believe the good news. Each of us did the work the Lord gave us. So people come and they will say, oh, Boss Atana, you're a woman of God. But here's the thing. If you are a man, you should be a man of God. Every woman should be a woman of God. And then he comes and he says, I did the work. He didn't say, I got the status, you know. He said, I did the work. And here he says in verse 6, I planted the seeds in your heart, and Apollos watered it, but it was God who made it grow. It was God who made it grow. Who made the seed grow? God made it grow. Verse 7, it is not important who does the planting, who does the watering. Let us understand this. It doesn't mean it's not important to water and plant. This is very crucial. It needs to be done, but it's not important who does it. He says at the end of the day, what's important is that God makes the seed grow. What is important? God makes the seed grow. And I see it even in raising my daughter, in raising our kids, you know. We might be thinking, oh, you know, it's my education. I'm the mother, I'm the father. All this, what I've been putting into them is my homeschooling that is doing this. Huh, you think it's because of you that your children are so awesome? No, it is God that brings growth in their lives. And I've realized in this time, and I've had tremendous challenges with homeschooling my daughter, and I've realized, but you know what, I can work as hard, I can do everything I want to, but if God doesn't work in her little life, then all the work that I do is for nothing. So we've got to understand what is important. Planting is important. It needs to be done. We need to do the work. We need to plant the seeds of the Word of God in people's lives. Watering is important. It's a work. It needs to be done. But then we need to understand that it is God who brings the growth in people's life. And maybe this is encouraging some of you that's been planting and watering, and you thought, what is happening? Well, let me tell you, God is bringing the growth in your finances. Who brings the growth? God brings the growth. You know, at the end of the day, everything is God. And if everything is God, who do we need to seek? We need to seek God. Because if we take God out of the processes through our quarreling and our bickering and our envy and our divisions and our ugly spirit and our self-ambitions, then we will plant and plant and water, but there will be no growth, because only God brings growth in our lives. And therefore, we've got to understand how important it is that we bring the holiness of God within our marriages. What is holiness? It is the accuracy of God. So we need to be accurate in our marriages, accurate in our mothering, in our fathering, accurate in the handling of our finances, doing it God's way, because if you're going to do it your own way, there will not be growth. But doing it God's way, because who brings the growth in your business? God brings it. Who brings the growth in your family? God brings it. And therefore, we need to know that God makes it grow. God brings the growth. It continues in verse 8. The one who plants and the one who waters work together with the same purpose. Can you see again? Same purpose, same heart, same vision. It says, and both will be rewarded for their own hard work. For we are both God's workers. And you are God's field. You are God's building. And therefore, verse 10. Because of God's grace to me, I've laid the foundation like an expert builder. Now others are building on it, but whoever is building on this foundation must be very careful, for no one can lay any foundation other than one we already have, and that is Jesus Christ. So you cannot build your life, your ministry, your family, the education of your children, or anything but Jesus Christ. Praise and worship is not the foundation. Intercession is not the foundation. Jesus is the foundation. And out of Jesus will flow praise and worship, will flow intercession within our lives. But the foundation is always Jesus, and it always will be. And now verse 12, and I want to finish this with this today. It says, anyone who builds on that foundation may use a variety of materials, gold, silver, jewels, wood, hay, or straw. But on the judgment day, fire will reveal what kind of work each builder has done. The fire will show if a person's work has any value. Who of you know that what you see on the outside is not necessarily what it is? But here we see that fire will show the value. Fire will prove. So maybe you will not know whether your marriage is a marriage until it's been tested by fire. Many things in our life, only until it is tested by fire, you know it is the real thing. And therefore you find, people taking candy floss, and it looks so big, and when you press it together, it's actually very small. And when you eat it, you see there's actually nothing on the inside, and there's only air. And a lot of people build their lives only on air. You know, they think it's going to last, but when the tests come, because let me tell you, something looks much different when there's no pressure on it than when it does, when the pressure comes on it. And when there's nothing on the inside, you're going to fall, you're going to fail, nothing is going to grow, it's going to work out within your life. And therefore, with urgency this morning, I'm speaking to you and say, let Jesus Christ be the foundation within your life. Because when you have Him as your foundation, you know you are accepted and the beloved of God. You know you are His crown. You know you are His joy. Then there will not be quarreling, bickering, divisions and fighting, but you will know your purpose, and that is to impact the life of many people. Therefore, make Jesus Christ your foundation in the raising of your children, in your marriage, in everything you do, in your finances, in your businesses. And know He is the foundation. It's the seeds of the Word that we plant in our lives, in our words, in our actions, in everything we do. Because once you are faithful and you do something according to the Word of God, it is a seed. And it keeps on stacking and stacking and stacking. And you know, the Word of God says that God will make it grow. And perhaps you listen to this word today and you realize that you've been struggling to get growth within your life. Things aren't working out. They're constantly collapsing. And especially in this time, regardless the challenges we are going through, let me tell you today, we are still the children of God. His hand is still over our lives. We still enjoy the provision and the power and the purpose of God within our lives. And just where you are, if you are the person that says, well, I'm struggling with growth and everything else has been my foundation except Jesus, I want to encourage you today, come and pray with me right now. Give your life over to God. Give everything over to Him. Start in the morning once again with your devotional time. Start with the Word of God. Get into prayer, because we know that whatever God does, it shall be forever. How do we get Him in our lives? We pray. We bring in the Word in everything we do. Come on, let's just pray together. Abba Father, I thank you for each and every person that is listening today. We come today and we ask you to forgive us, Lord, for making our families the foundation, making our finances, our education, our social status, Lord, making our talents, our praise and worship, making that the foundation of our lives. And Lord, we ask you to forgive us, Lord, when we know when you, Jesus Christ, is the foundation of our lives, with what you have done on the cross through your blood, Lord, that redemption should be the foundation, your forgiveness, you cleansing us, you sanctifying us, and you justifying us, and you see us as if we've never sinned. That should be the foundation, and from all that, all life will flow. And therefore, Lord, we commit our marriages, our children, our businesses, our workplace, our finances, we commit it unto you this morning. And Lord, we will do it God's way. And Father, thank you that as we are doing it your way, thank you for the growth that we will see within our lives in every area, because Lord, you want us to be blessed. You want us to have and experience your undeserved and unmerited and unearned favor upon our lives. And thank you this morning, as we become faithful in our finances, you open the windows of heaven over our lives. Faithful in our marriages, Lord, thank you that you give us that satisfaction in our marriages that only you can give. In our children, Lord, where we see where they excel at school and everything they do, because Lord Jesus, you are the foundation, not their happiness, not what they want, but Lord, you are the foundation, and therefore we see growth. And thank you that we can seal this prayer in Jesus' name through your Spirit, knowing that it is yes and amen, knowing this is the will of God, knowing this is God's way, knowing that we will see the growth of God within our lives in the time to come. And we thank you for that in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. So, go do love God's way, make Jesus the foundation, see the growth in your life. God bless you. Joy.